Last week, I went to see the annual holiday small work show at the Rosenfeld Gallery in Philadelphia.
It's filled with great art and loads of wonderful artists. Richard explained the genesis of the show and told me about a few of the artists that I picked out at random.
This is my annual small work show. I love to do it. It's one of my favorite shows of the year. I've hung this show from front to back, the most abstract to the most realistic. I started this show the first year I went into business about 33 years ago. My gallery is pretty much based around doing one-person shows. It just didn't seem right for somebody to wait a year or 2 years to do a show and to make them show in December because people are so preoccupied by the holidays. So I used the opportunity to do a group show. 33 years ago, a lot of the art was $50, $100, and people could buy them as presents. People got Christmas bonuses, and very often couples would come in and they would buy a piece of art for each other with their Christmas bonuses. Those times have long since gone, but I've continued to do the show, and I still have people buying presents for each other. That's the history of the show, and I hope to continue doing it forever. I'm very proud of the group of artists I put together, and I tend to talk about it in sports metaphors. It's traditional to call your artist your stable, and I guess that's a sports metaphor. I have a lot of different horses that I show, and I try to balance it between, to use another sports metaphor, rookies and long-term people, veterans. It's good to have a balance, and every year I do a new talent show to bring new people in. Some of the people that I brought in as young people 30 years ago are now some of the best known artists in the area. I look for that balance. The stable that I've had has always been so diverse that people have asked me, what do I specialize in? And my glib answer used to be, well, I specialize in diversity. And it's not really that, just a joke, I really do. Basically, I'm looking for artists that are very committed to what they're doing, that learn from their own work, do it and do it again a little different, and use art as a form of personal expression. And I think I've put together a group of people that are all very serious that way, and I just can't wait to see what happens next with all of them. Artists feel less self-conscious when they're doing small things, and sometimes they take them out of the regular routine of doing what they usually do. They'll try something new and when they're working smaller. Now, Tremaine Smith is a case in point this year. She usually does very large encaustic works on wood. Now she started to do this series of acrylics and collage on paper. Totally different materials for her, and she's trying lots of different kinds of images, and she said it helps her develop new ideas quicker. It's one of the advantages of asking artists to work small. A lot of the ones that work large when they work small sometimes will do very precious little things that are really delightful. One of the media that's really taken art by storm over the past 15 or 20 years is encaustic, working with hot pigmented wax. In this show we have six artists that are working in wax. Yale Roberts is certainly one of the better known ones. He's one of the few that I know of that really works in a more realistic fashion. The wax is very recalcitrant and doesn't really want to go where you want it to go all the time. A lot of artists use it to do abstract works with big shapes. But Dale's been working with it now as his major media for about 20 years, and he's gotten such finesse with it. He can do just about anything he wants with it. These are so wonderful because they're right on the cusp of being realistic and abstract at the same time. This is the work of Matt Duffin, and I've just been showing him for a few months. I saw his work in an art magazine and I was so struck by it that I called him and invited him to be in the gallery. I don't usually do that. Usually I want to see actual pieces first, but I was so enthralled. The technique is unique. Again, it's encaustic. He starts out with a a white ground on a board, and then he puts a very thick layer of black pigmented wax on it. Then for months he will scrape it into it, almost like a scratchboard technique, with very fine dental tools. His aesthetic and his technique are perfect for each other. They're very theatrical and they're very mysterious, and there's a certain irony and almost whimsy to them all at once. They're terrific. Leo Sewell is unique. He's been making animals out of and other things out of found objects for years. He's one of the original dumpster divers. And really now he has work all over the world. I think one of the reasons why Leo's work works so well, because a lot of people try to do this, is that he has such a wonderful sense of form. Like, look at this raven. It looks like a raven. He's caught the gestalt, the actual physicality of a raven. And by using all these found objects, he's able to really catch the spirit of it. A lot of artists eventually develop a very strong voice, something about their work that's very personal and very much their own. And I say voice instead of style, because voice seems more all-inclusive. It includes the aesthetic as well as the way the paint's put on. I think Mark Green has a very, very, very strong voice, and you kind of enter into his world. The technique is something he's developed all on his own. It's the use of oil paint, turpentine, and wax. And instead of having to heat it like a true encaustic, the turpentine keeps the wax fluid and he can just paint with it. And occasionally squeegee it flat to get that flat surface that gives it a lot of tension. He's always done houses, but they're houses from the inside of him, not something that you would really live in. They're like dream states in there. They're beautifully done, but they're a little bit off-putting. There's that wonderful balance between the physical beauty of the forms and the strangeness. Mary Spinelli's been one of the real mainstays of my gallery for the 34 years I've been in business. She's probably had 17 or 18 one-person shows, and she's been in just about all my small work shows. She's just unique. She's developed her own imagery, and it gets more luminous every year and just more mysterious. This is the work of Keith Pirelli. He's another new artist for me. I saw his work in an art magazine and I immediately fell in love with it. He lives and works in New Orleans. He has a tremendous facility. He can just, if he can think of it, he can paint it. These pieces by Dan Malcheski, these very lyrical horses, are made by taking a piece of copper plate and cutting it to shape to make the body of the horse. Then he makes his own resin compound, I'm not sure what's in it, and he kind of builds it up. And then he puts these incredible finishes on them. I think the finish, he puts just as much attention in the finish and the colors as he does in the forms. And the forms and the colors, the shapes all work together so well. This is the work of Paul Stanker, who is one of the two or three best known glass artists in the world. These are what he calls orbs. They're globes, so they can be turned on the base and you can see them from every angle. It's almost like the universe in a drop of water. I've developed a deep and abiding respect for artists and the creative ability. It's something I tried to do the first part of my life and I couldn't do it. I've been in a very privileged situation over the past 35 years, dealing with artists over a long period of time, talking to them about their work, having them explain things to me, seeing it come in and grow and change. It's been a fantastic learning experience for me and very enriching.
So there you have it. A heck of a good art show with a dealer who's a real mensch. I advise you all to try to check out the Rosenfeld Small Work Show before it ends. See ya.